Hello, I'm Casey McRae. In this training module, I will introduce you to the basics of high-speed serial communication using FPD-Link. We assume by this point you are familiar with FPD-Link as a communication protocol to transfer high-speed serial data in rugged applications like automotive vehicles. Today we'll take a peek inside FPD-Link at some of the circuit components and sub-blocks that make this data transmission possible. At the end of this training module, you'll have a better understanding of some of the challenges in transferring high-speed data over serial links and how to address those challenges. FPD-Link is a multi-protocol physical layer technology that aggregates data from various industry standard protocols and transfers it over cables. It is primarily used in automotive vehicles and most commonly for digital audio-video transfer between video screens or driver assistance cameras. Some examples are shown here in these vehicle diagrams. Here's an example of an FPD-Link-based system where we have shown the internal blocks that enable successful transmission and reception of serial data. Starting from the left, an FPD-Link serializer typically includes a PLL, or phase lock loop, to multiply the pixel clock by the same factor as a parallel to serial converter in order to drive a single-ended 50-ohm cable or a differential 100-ohm cable. Additionally, an FPD-Link serializer includes a back-channel receiver to recover data that was sent across the same physical link from the deserializer side. Now, along the way, the high-speed serial signal is going to be subject to impairments, such as jitter, crosstalk, reflections, attenuation, and dispersion. In order to recover the serial signal from these impairments, an FPD-Link deserializer includes an adaptive equalizer and a clock and data recovery block to recover data and extract the clock used to retime the data. Finally, the high-speed data is fed into a serial-to-parallel converter to replicate the parallel data that was sent as an input to the serializer. Additionally, an FPD-Link deserializer includes a back-channel transmitter to send control information over a single-ended 50-ohm cable or differential 100-ohm cable. PLL stands for phase lock loop, and is a major analog component of FPD-Link used inside both the serializer as well as in the FPD-Link deserializer. Inside an FPD-Link serializer, a PLL takes a reference clock and generates a higher speed serial clock, which is usually a multiple of n of the reference clock frequency. In an FPD-Link deserializer, the PLL is used to extract the clock from the high speed data stream. The clock and data recovery block, also known as CDR, is a fundamental subsystem inside the FPD-Link deserializer. This circuit extracts the clock from the serial FPD-Link data and retimes the recovered data. A simple CDR block diagram is shown here, outlining the major components like the PLL and a sampler. How much jitter a CDR can tolerate drives the overall system jitter specification. Input reference clock jitter, transmit jitter requirement, channel effects, and CDR jitter tolerance set the specification for overall end-to-end FPD-Link system performance. An eye diagram is an effective way to study the impact of jitter on a high-speed channel used for FPD-Link. It is constructed by superimposing multiple unit intervals of high-speed data taken one at a time between zero crossings as shown here. The size of an eye opening determines the quality of the signal. As shown, each of the neighboring symbols will bleed into the current sample being looked at, causing an eye closure. This effect of interference from neighboring symbols is termed as inter-symbol interference, or ISI. For more detailed discussion on this topic, please find the Precision Labs training module, What is an Eye Diagram? All jitter is not created equal. Random jitter must be minimized at the source as much as possible, since random jitter cannot be compensated or canceled in an effective manner on the deserializer side. Certain frequency components of random jitter can be filtered out, but this can also filter out data components and can lead to its own challenges. However, we can compensate for deterministic jitter, since it is predictable and consistent. Linear adaptive equalization, for example, can help remove some of the deterministic jitter introduced due to channel losses. Deterministic jitter, for the most part, is introduced due to losses in the channel, while random jitter is introduced due to effects like power supply noise, crosstalk, and reflections due to channel discontinuities. We can now get a little bit more detail relating back to this slide and look at the three main system components for jitter. Jitter can be introduced at the serializer end due to effects like power supply noise, periodic jitter on the input reference clock, or inside the serializer package pins. Jitter can be introduced on the channel, which is made up of PCB, connector, and cable assembly, or inside the deserializer due to the band limiting of the high-speed signal path, uncancelled back channel echo, intrinsic noise inside VCO, or power supply noise. The picture above shows the variation of attenuation, or loss, introduced by different cable lengths over frequency. Signal loss introduced by a cable can be studied using S parameters. For example, S21 parameters give information about cable attenuation, also called insertion loss. This figure shows losses listed in dB numbers at 700 MHz and 1.4 GHz, as well as losses for different cable lengths. As can be seen, higher data rates or longer cable lengths show higher losses. In TI's FPD-Link system, we introduce an adaptive equalization at the deserializer, which can compensate for these insertion losses in the channel. An example of ISI, or inter-symbol interference, on high-speed FPD-Link data is shown here. As data traverses the cable, the eye opening is completely closed as shown by the picture after the channel. An equalizer is then used to compensate for the cable loss by providing an inverse gain function to the signal. In summary in this lesson, we covered some of the key challenges in transferring high-speed data over cables for an automotive environment, including channel losses and jitter. We also shed some light on some of the techniques used by the FPD-Link devices to solve those challenges. All right, let's take a quick quiz. Number one, what kind of jitter is introduced due to signal attenuation inside a cable? A, random jitter. B, deterministic jitter. Or C, periodic jitter. The answer is B, deterministic jitter. Since signal loss of a cable is defined and deterministic, the cable will attenuate the signal in a specific deterministic way, thus creating deterministic jitter. Number two, what kind of method is used to compensate for random jitter introduced due to power supply noise? Is it A, adaptive equalization? B, random jitter introduced due to power supply noise cannot be reduced? Or C, some of the random jitter effects due to power supply noise can be reduced by filtering the data stream? The answer is C. Some of the random jitter due to power supply noise can be reduced by filtering the data, and filtering can be an effective way as long as the supply noise components are at a much higher frequency compared to the data frequency components. In closing, I'm glad we could give you some of the high-speed basics for FPD-Link technology. You can see what TI products work with the FPD-Link protocol and access some great technical resources at TI.com. Thanks everyone for watching.